My name is Tim Wilson. I'm going to talk a little bit about network analysis and complexity analysis. So I should preface the talk by saying I consider myself kind of a hack in this area. I'm not formally trained in complexity science or chaos theory and all this sort of stuff, but I'm very interested in it. So I think of myself as more kind of a mystic. I have no obligation to anyone with this work, so I'm kind of free to let my mind wander. So that's kind of the little preface. So don't use any of this stuff for like a formal type of job unless you kind of double and triple and quadruple check it. Okay, so so the plan at a high level is I'm going to say a bunch of stuff, and then we'll go eat. I'll start off by talking about complex systems, and then I'll get into modeling our social world, which is obviously very complex. From there, I'll go into the network abstraction, which is a nice way to model complex phenomenon. And then I'll talk specifically about reducing a network or community detection or network partitioning. And then I'll talk about how I'm actually using this this technology in analyzing Twitter. So I'm not going to actually show code. I'm going to talk high level about kind of theory and algorithms. But I wanted to say at the very beginning, Python is a wonderful stack that has an amazing amount of scientific libraries, not just scientific libraries, great web libraries, great integration with Postgres, which Postgres is capable of handling terabytes and terabytes of data. You don't have to... anytime you're considering a big data project, you don't have to immediately go to Hadoop and Java. There's wonderful tools here with Python. I think every language has its purpose, but I also feel that I'm most productive with Python. And just don't, if you're dealing with lots of data, don't be intimidated to use Python. And there's a lot here. So, things are related in strange and complex ways. You'll see this picture a few times. I think it's a really cool picture. This is actually taken from the internet, but it looks very much like a, I don't know how well it looks to you guys, but it looks very much like a biological organism, I think, which I think is pretty cool. So this is just more evidence that things are... Our world is very complicated. This is Daniel Dennett, who's a modern famous philosopher, and you can tell he's a great philosopher because of his beard. So, in the study of complex systems and system science in general, you eventually get into this idea of determinism. And I've spent a decent amount of time kind of thinking about deterministic systems, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that right now. So the idea, high level of determinism, is everything is involved in a cause and effect correlation, and taken to the extreme, you could even say that our whole universe is deterministic and maybe started from the Big Bang, and it's kind of moving in a predefined deterministic pattern. So when I was a small boy, I was raised in a very religious household, and I can remember going to church and thinking about this problem, and I thought it was very strange. They said, so God, this like all-powerful being, knows what's going to happen, but yet he still kind of holds you responsible. And I thought, wow, that's weird. So that, I think that was kind of the start of this thinking about this predetermined life and determinism in general. It's important to note that complexity and chaos does not mean indeterminism. So just because we have a complex, chaotic system, it doesn't mean that it's not determined. Perhaps everything is determined. Markets, socioeconomic position, our thoughts and actions, the universe. Quantum theory suggests otherwise. So modern quantum thinking and a lot of philosophy and religion will say, obviously, that things are not determined and there is a necessary incompleteness in our world. Also, just throw this in, and this is not an absolute perfect fit, but I think it's a nice correlation. We can't know about the future without affecting it, so you have this weird feedback loop. So even if things are determined, it's impossible for us to take advantage of that. So I'll leave this for as a question for religion and philosophy. And I'll just use this general statement that will kind of guide the rest of what I'm going to talk about. Our world is deterministic enough to make probabilistic predictions about it.
So you have free will, but we don't.
Well, I don't really know. I don't know about who has free will, or I like to think that we all do. But I guess what I'm saying here is that we can predict certain things with some probability. So a very interesting one, and something I've been researching lately, is socioeconomic mobility. And you can compare that in various countries. You can make startling predictions about how people will end up socioeconomically just based on who their parents are, where they're born, these sort of things. So we can make these sort of predictions. But going back to the last slide, maybe once we start to kind of see these predictions, maybe we can do things to change them. Okay, so maybe the crowning achievement of chaos theory is what they call the butterfly effect. And this is more than just a great movie by Ashton Kutcher. Yeah. And the general idea is that small changes can have very diverse effects. So you could kind of look at this in a certain light. You could say there are tipping points and phase transitions and pockets of extreme influence. And by making strategic improvements, can we have positive cascades where a small improvement propagates larger benefits? Or can we do more with less? And I have a bunch of examples here. So can we move markets with the right incentives? And this is what, you know, a lot of our economic policy is kind of driven towards. Can we develop superorganisms by targeting the right genes? Can we cure mental illness by targeting the right neural receptors? Can a politician get elected by convincing the right opinion leaders? And the one that I'm going to focus on, the very last one, can we improve knowledge management systems by identifying the right subject matter experts? So that's kind of what I'm using to drive this work that I'm doing, analyzing Twitter. Okay, so modeling our social world. I picked this picture because I think it shows very nicely how irrational we can be, which is a lot of the beauty of being human is that we're not kind of these mechanized robots. We do things that are really go against, you know, everything that we should be doing. So the market, I'd say, is the holy grail of complexity analysis. The game is very simple. If you can predict the future better than your competition, you can win a lot of money. And everyone's heard of John Maynard Keynes, and he says here that the reason this is very hard is because the market consists of people, and people are irrational. Luckily, I'm here, and I have access to a lot of tools and data, and I can do this sort of research in my free time. And my wife, who's here, is very supportive of that, so that's nice as well. And the reason I can do this is because I'm living in an age where I have access to technology like Python in the libraries I mentioned, and also vast amounts of social data. So before the web, it was very, very difficult to get statistically significant amounts of social information. Now, today, it's a lot easier. So you can imagine all the places where you can get information about people, their interests, their relationships. So, you know, I list a lot there. There are a lot of publicly available data sets that academia makes available. There is a wealth of information. And even though we have this wealth of information, it's still not an ideal model of our social lives, but it's much, much, much better than we've ever had before. Okay, so the network abstraction. I don't go into it too much here. I mean, there's a lot you can get into with network science, and the very rudimentary is you kind of have nodes and edges, and those edges are relationships between nodes. Those edges can hold properties, so they can have values. The nodes themselves can have values and properties. I think the really important thing is that universally, amongst a lot of people working in the fields of complexity analysis and system science, universally everyone has kind of settled on the network abstraction. And because everyone has settled on it and found value in using it, there are a lot of great tools that are built on top of it. And there's a lot of energy and work that's being done around it. So a few examples of problems that can be represented with a network: gene expression networks, our immune system, our brains, our social worlds, and not just our human social worlds, but also animals and plants, and all this stuff can be represented as a complex network. So a few characteristics of a complex network. And this is generalized, and these properties pretty much hold true with complex natural networks. A small diameter, and what that means is the number of hops it takes to reach any node in the network. And you'll recognize this as the small world phenomenon. No one knows absolutely for sure, but studies have said that there's 6 degrees of separation between any person in the entire world, which is pretty impressive. There's more clustering than you would see in a random network. So if we just randomly threw out a bunch of nodes and connected them with random edges, we see in these natural complex networks that there's a lot more pockets of densely connected people. And this this idea of looking at pockets of densely connected edges is the thrust of what I'll be talking about later. The other thing that we see are power law degree distributions. And so this is commonly known as kind of the rich get richer. But the idea is that if there's a node in the network and it has a lot of people pointing to it, it's very likely that it'll get more and more people pointing to it. And that's because it's easy to find that node in the network, because you can go to people that are already pointing to it. And that in itself is a field of study, and why kind of we see this. But we see it everywhere in our natural world, and obviously it's kind of what we complain about in an economic sense, I guess, depending on where you lie. But it seems to be a naturally occurring phenomenon. Okay, so this is the same image that I had at the beginning, and it's just kind of representing the scale of what we have now available through the internet. So my focus, there's a lot of different topics and sub kind of focuses within network science. My focus has been reducing a network down, not necessarily, this is obviously two dimensions, and this is actually done by LinkedIn, but not necessarily reducing a network to two dimensions, but reducing it in the sense of identifying communities in a network, and then using those discovered communities as latent features to do other things. But I think this is a very nice visualization of kind of the idea in general. Okay, so what I'll get into is the duality between compression and pattern detection. And what I mean by that is, if you can compress something, inherently what that means is you've discovered patterns in it. And so we're going to apply this the same way of thinking to networks. And we're going to see if we can squeeze the essence from a network. And then we're going to see if we can use this essence in some way. So when you get into this idea of dimension reduction, there are a ton of methods available. So what I did for a long time is just basically try out different methods. I've explored methods in signal processing, machine learning. I was interested a while ago in the Netflix Prize. And in the Netflix Prize, one of the methods that did very well is what they call non-negative matrix factorization, which is essentially a way of reducing the dimensionality of a matrix. So I applied and tried using that method for network reduction. I tried various clustering methods. And then I started using methods that were very specific to this problem, methods that were actually called community detection within a network. And I also tried methods that were kind of labeled as network partitioning methods. And what you find with all these different types of methods, I mean, they're all developed with different problems in mind, and they all excel at various things, and they all have different scalability factors as well. So when you throw into it that these networks are very, very big, so the Twitter network is millions, hundreds of millions of nodes, you have to also consider kind of the performance of the algorithm. So a little more on network reduction later. Let's see how I'm doing on time. So I'm going to talk now about my specific application, which is applying this sort of network reduction community detection to Twitter. And so it's just some things that kind of shaped why I thought Twitter would be a good model. But obviously, if you're familiar with Twitter, you know exactly what it offers. I like this quote at the bottom. He says, you can think of Twitter as a network of human sensors. And I thought that was kind of a cool way to think of it. It's almost like the Matrix. We're all kind of plugged into this big internet machine and feeding it. We're enslaved by it. So here's the picture again. I think maybe this is a cool way to look at our world. Maybe it's not that we're all individuals, but we're all connected, and we're this big social organism. Okay, so what I'm going to show next is basically identifying communities, and in the case I'm going to show you is I've identified a lot of communities on Twitter, and then it's taking those communities that I've identified and finding people that are placed in between communities. So if I can say, give me this community that's, you know, moms, and give me this community of people that are into dirt, you know, crazy, like, extreme sports and dirt bike racing, and let me see the people that are in between those. That's an example. So what the one I did, I wanted to do something appropriate for their conference. So I said, give me the community that is, you know, the most Pythonic community that I've identified in Twitter. And how I actually decide that this one community is the most Pythonic, I can talk about later. And then I said, give me this other community that is Ohio software, and then show me the people that are in between those two. And so the very first person is Catherine Devlin, and the next one is Pi Ohio. I'm not sure who Greg is, but he's probably here. I'm guessing he is. He's into beards, so I'm guessing he has to be in the Python. And he's obviously from Columbus. Okay, so I'm going to... show the application that I have. I don't know how well this turns out. I don't think you can actually read. Can you read any of this?
No.
Okay. I can read it to you. So what this is doing is focusing on Kathleen Devlin, and it's showing all the communities that are related to her, ranked by the communities that she's following the most. So on the top is a Python and Django community. The next one is a software community that's software developers in and around Ohio. And most of them are into .NET. The next community is Northeast Ohio Ruby Columbus people.
That's the one with 226 members?
Yeah. The next one is scientific Python people. And the next one is Plone, which I forgot existed. Let me see. I can go down some more, too. Ruby, Dayton, Mozilla, GitHub, Cincinnati, Founders, some more... What's that?
Click on it somewhere to get rid of that.
Okay.
So which one of those number counts are associated with the community?
Yeah, with how many members are in the community.
These are communities that Twitter doesn't know about. You've constructed these.
Yeah, right. So these communities were discovered, and I'll get into the kind of geeky math of how they were discovered, but the communities themselves are just discovered looking at the network, and that's it. So it's just looking at the people who they follow, and that's it. So what's nice about that is you can apply this same science to a lot of different problems. It's not specific to Twitter. Okay, I'm going to try to get back to... Okay, so here are a few other examples of kind of doing this, this same sort of thing, identifying two communities and finding individuals that are kind of in between those two. So this one is Python in healthcare. And the first person I found is the U.S. Chief Technology Officer, assistant to the president. The next is a surgeon, writer, and researcher. And the final is a data journalist that's into healthcare. I did the same thing with Python and art. And the first guy is an artist, Django developer. This person, the second person, is someone that helps startups. And the third person is, their description says, I paint things, sometimes I make software, sometimes I make people. You look amazing today. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about actually kind of the geeky details of how I was able to do this. So the first thing is actually getting the information. And the first problem that you'll kind of run into is that the people kind of that own this information, they realize it's valuable. A lot of people realize it's valuable. So LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, the NSA knows it's valuable. Marketing agencies understand that it's valuable. So with LinkedIn, if you have an auth token, so someone signs up for your application, you're allowed to get one degree. So you're allowed to get their connections, essentially. That's it. LinkedIn is very protective of their network. It's essentially their whole business. So rightfully so, I guess you could argue. Facebook is a little better. You can go 2 degrees from the authenticating person. And Twitter is much different. If you have an auth token, Twitter just says you have to abide by these rate limits. And it used to be 360 queries an hour per auth token. And now they reduced that down to 60 queries an hour per auth token. And I'm speaking specifically about getting the network, so getting the people that people follow. Okay, so this gets into kind of the guts of how the community detection algorithm works. And the first bit to explain is looking at a network as a Markov process. And what this means, and you can kind of use these terms interchangeably. People also call it, they call them random walkers. But what the nice characteristic of a Markov process is if you fix the transition probabilities. So if I'm a random walker and I visit node A, what's the probability that I'll visit people that node A is connected to? And typically that's, it can get more nuanced than this, but typically it is the number of people that node A follows, that total divided by the number of people. So if I follow 10 people, the probability of a random walker going to one of those 10 people is 1 in 10. So if we fix these transition probabilities, the interesting property of a Markov process is it'll eventually settle to an equilibrium. So the number of random walkers at any given node will stay constant. And this is the essence of the original PageRank algorithm. And the geeky like science term for it is iridescity. But that's the first thing that kind of you have to understand how this community detection algorithm works. So the next piece is a minimization function or an objective function. And the objective function is concerned with minimizing the description of the Markov process. So essentially compressing the Markov process. So we want to find a network partition that minimizes the bits required to describe our random walk. And the way that we actually find this ideal network partition is with computers. So computers are very good at just trying a lot of different combinations of network partitions, and we can keep on looking at how they perform against the minimization function, and can improve the partition. Now there are a lot. This is a kind of field of study on its own, which is like optimization and search throughout massive spaces, and there are a lot of methods like gradient descent and hill climbing. The method that this actually uses is a method called simulated annealing, which essentially tries a bunch of things, makes a lot of random mutations, and then slows down how many random mutations it's making. Tries it and compares that to other random mutations that it's doing. So the map equation was created by this guy, Martin Rosvell. He's a physicist in Sweden. So just to give you an idea of like the diversity of people that are kind of working on these problems. And I've written emails to this guy. I've told him he's like a hippie physicist. Yeah, he did. He was happy that I thought of him in that way. So here's kind of what a characterization of him, I guess.
What does that phrase mean?
I think he's saying that like his person is not constant. Like his identity is always different depending on, I don't know, maybe the chemicals in his mind. Okay, so here's the cool piece. All that stuff about Markov processes and using information theory to compress the description of the Markov process, all that stuff you don't have to worry about. You really don't, because it's all in this library, igraph, that's written in C++. It has Pythons to R, and it has bindings to Python and R. It's very fast and efficient, and it has a lot of other state-of-the-art network algorithms, including Martin's algorithm. So all I really did was I found this library. It has a lot of different community detection algorithms. I tried all of them, and I found that this one worked the best. And then after that, I researched kind of how it was actually working. So the problems with igraph is that everything needs to fit into memory. And when you're talking about a massive internet scale network, that's hard to do. And it's also serial, so it only will run on a single processor. So so how do we scale this? Well, there are distributed systems. Google has one that they call Pregl. There was one created at Carnegie Mellon called GraphLab, and there's an Apache project for one. It turns out Hadoop is not good at large-scale graph analysis. The kind of properties that make Hadoop good at MapReduce are not very good for large-scale graph analysis. So we have these systems that I was describing. The problem is really good natural community detection is still an unsolved problem in this distributed environment. I mean, it's a whole different problem to take Martin's algorithm and then make it work in this distributed vertex-centric environment. So what I did, I just accepted that everything needs to fit in the memory, and I put an emphasis on good partitioning. And at that point, the problem becomes very easy. And they refer to this as embarrassingly parallel. So accepting everything needs to fit into memory, the first thing you want to do is get lots of memory. And the reality is memory is very cheap now. I built a machine, I think it was like $1,500, and I have 64 gigs of RAM. You can buy machines for like $5,000 or $6,000 that have like 256 gigs of RAM, or maybe even five something, whatever. So memory is pretty cheap. So You can still do this sort of stuff at home. And then what I did was I discovered communities, and then I treated those discovered communities as a network. And then I applied the same sort of algorithms to find communities of communities. And this helped me get these kind of higher level types of partitions that I could say, okay, run this partition, this wall fit into memory, now run this next partition. The other thing I have is what I call streaming network inclusion or community inclusion. And what I do is I model the initial community inclusion as a game. So when I pull in a new node from Twitter that is not a member of a community, I run through an algorithm that just kind of intuitively made sense to me. I look at all the communities and I see which communities are most interested in this individual. And then I look at the individual and see what communities that person is interested in. And if there is a match, then I include that person in the community. And it's just a very simple initial heuristic to get them into a partition. So just some other nice things about network. Networks of communities give you other nice network stats. So you have, when you treat a community as a node, you can find the relationships it has with other communities. You can find its degree and centrality and its position. Also, what I was describing is network of communities give you hierarchical communities. And then we can partition as needed. So what am I kind of considering to do from here? I'm looking at scaling up and adding more computers, bandwidth, and data. So what's interesting about, I guess, Twitter apps in general is the more people that sign up for the application, the more data you can actually pull from Twitter. And the same is true with LinkedIn and Facebook. What I'm also interested in doing is using communities as latent features to predict and recommend people to follow and content of interest. And this is this would start to get into what they classify as like supervised learning, where you have some labeled data, where you have kind of, you know that some people are interested in certain people and some people are interested in certain content. And you use these communities to then predict other people that would be interested in this content and people. So I have like a sappy quote here. This is a quote from Steve Jobs. So what you'll find a lot, and when you're kind of researching this, there's like really heavy like scientific jargon and stuff, and you'll tend to kind of get, and not just network science, but I'm sure a lot of really geeky science. There's a lot of stuff there that can be intimidating. It's okay to just like skip through all this stuff and just find things that make sense to you. And over time, the stuff will start to make more sense. I think this is not true, certainly in all of academia, but in some parts of academia, people have an interest in kind of them being the only ones that know certain things, and they don't make it accessible to other people. So that said, don't overlook existing science tools and resources, because there's a ton of stuff out there. And that's it.
So if we wanted to sign up, how do we do that?
So If you want to sign up, you just go to smarttypes.org, and that's it. You'll see like a button that says sign in with your Twitter account. And that's good for me, because then I can like pull more data. So that's nice. So
are you gonna narc us out to the NSA?
Yeah, so Matt's question was, am I going to narc people out to the NSA, and that's actually who's funding this project. I didn't want to tell you guys. So sign up, and I'll see if you're a terrorist, and then if you are even remotely related to terrorists, I will give your information to
the...
Yeah, right. If you're into weird stuff I don't like, then I'll also. Yeah.
A couple of quick questions. On a couple of slides, you had a list of the stack that you use for Python to handle all of this. Is there a way to get access to that slide, or are slides available?
Sure. So the question was, can I? And this deck will be available, but the question was, what was the stack? And here it is, you know, right now. But I'll also make the deck available to everyone. Yeah, yeah. So the question is, how am I actually storing the graph? And I'm storing it in Postgres. I'm storing a node as a row, and then Postgres has an array type. I'm storing all of the edges in an array inside of the same row.
I see. So it's something slightly more sophisticated than just a typical spreadsheet row column thing. Postgres will actually tag an array.
Yeah. Yeah, and I debated about doing a proper join table. The problem that you would run into is that you have to keep on joining against that join table. And the number of edges, so I have roughly like 5 million people, and the average person follows like 400 people, so you can do the math. You know, 5 million times 400, that's how many edges I have. So that join table would get very, very big, and to join against it all the time would be computationally intensive. That said, I'm considering adding that join table, but right now I just use an array type. Yeah. So the question is, did I try using NetworkX? That's another great network analysis library. I know I've seen courses on Coursera that use NetworkX as kind of the foundation of teaching the course. I haven't personally used it. I remember messing around with it. I started this like 2.5 years ago, and I was messing around with it at the very beginning. But I was looking, when I decided I was going to look specifically at community detection, I found it was recommended to me that I look at igraph because they have a lot of community detection algorithms. But so I can't really say.
The other question I have is, how did you identify the communities? I could see how you could identify that there is a cluster or there is a group of common interests. How did you identify, for example, that it was the Ruby common interest as opposed to the general?
So what I did. Okay. So the question is, how do I actually identify that it's a Ruby community or a Python community? At the beginning, I'm just looking at dense clusters of edges, and when I find one, or Martin's method finds one, I don't know anything about it at that point. I just know that it's a community. Then what I did was took the descriptions of all the people in that community, and I used a method that's in scikit-learn. It's called document frequency, text frequency inverse document frequency, or maybe I'm getting that backwards, but it's a way of essentially pulling out tags from a large corpus of text. So that's how, and that's how I kind of tagged the communities after I had them.
So if they all talk about the same phrases, you grab those common phrases.
Yeah. And it's comparing it to all the other communities, so it's identifying what's unique about what these guys are talking about. They're talking about Python more often than everyone else out there. Go ahead, Mike. Yeah, it's time for lunch, but go ahead, Mike.
Why did you choose Postgres over
GraphQL?
You started on Mongo, right?
Yeah, I started using Mongo, and that was a horrible experience for me.
Did everyone hear that?
Maybe. No, yeah. I was I thought Mongo would be nice because I could distribute it across machines. The problem I ran into with Mongo, and I think they fixed some of these issues, but they were like really horrendous issues. Like when you would write to the database, not only would like a table lock, you know, Postgres has row level locking, right? Not only would a table lock, the whole database would lock, the whole thing. And I think they've like fixed that. But that was the first issue I ran into. And then I had like memory crashes, like it was running out of memory, and it was crashing. And it was just all this stuff that was happening, and I thought, you know, I'm going to go with something that's been around forever and that you know, a lot of people are using, and I'm happy with it. We've since, I used to work with Mike at a company called OnShift, and we engaged with some Postgres, they call themselves Postgres experts, and they've told us they work with people in the financial industry that have terabytes, hundreds of terabytes of data using Postgres, and it's working fine. So I'm very happy with Postgres. I think that's it. Thanks.